Aloha, ladies and gentlemen. This is Jeremy Vaney, and you are listening to The Experience. I am super excited about this week's episode. It's not often that I give my official stamp of you've got to get this approval, but if you're a non-subscriber, this is the good stuff. In fact, it's a slow build, and I don't think you're even getting a millionth of what's great about this episode in the first half of this show, as good as it is. So right up front here, I'm going to say, please subscribe. And if there's any issue in subscribing with unknown country, then wait until it's fixed and subscribe and listen to this episode. It is fantastic. And for me, part of a life changer. I had said last week that I was going to talk about some minor experiences that happened after the last episode. And I'm actually going to hold off on that. One, because I think they're still unfolding. And two, because this show is long enough and super fantastic all on its own. But also, just in editing this show right now, today, which is Thursday, I had a number of just insights that flooded me about life, the universe, and everything. And I don't mean the normal good old-fashioned insights. I mean the life-changing things where it reminds me of when I had the big I am experience, the lead up to that, the logical revelations that happened that preceded that. So I just told my wife, don't be surprised if this leads to another change, or at least things are going to get a little weird around here. And I'm actually giving a public talk this week about my experiences, and I was still sort of wondering, okay, how am I going to actually frame this so that it makes sense? And now I know. But beyond that, I think I got something here about the nature of interdimensional shenanigans and all that goes along with it. Synchronicities, I mean, go down the list of things. I get what's going on here. I think. At least partially. And so once I know how to really articulate it well, I'll say more. But in the meantime, I mean, I almost thought, oh, well, maybe this is so important that I should tell Whitley to, or beg him to please make this entire episode free. But honestly, I don't know that it will matter on a grand scale to anyone except maybe me. I mean, it will be intellectually interesting and theoretically interesting to anyone else, but as far as it actually changing you, transforming you, or leading to that, I don't know that it will, in the same way that the I am experience in articulating that isn't exactly changing lives, right? Because it has to come from you. So maybe it's not that important for everyone, but for me, this has been a bit of an interesting week that right here in editing this show has led to being a whirlwind of revelation. So thank you, my guest Crystal, right up front, and my friend Willie, and people involved in last week's roundtable, and my wife. I think this is all these conversations have actually moved me in some way. And I think this episode will move you, because here's a woman who has really no interest in any of this stuff. But she's clearly grounded, clearly a good person, steward of the earth, and an innocent in this. And that's what's necessary, which is why I say, please don't read anything. Don't read. Don't get bogged down in books and translations. Go through your own experiences. However, having said that, she did create an email specifically for listeners to contact her, which I'll give out at the end of the show for both subscribers and non-subscribers. Unfortunately, again, non-subscribers, you're gonna miss the unicorn story too. I mean, to me, that's central. Rare is the day that one believes somebody who says they've seen a unicorn, but oh, I believe. And that is the magical thing about a guest such as Crystal. I don't think there's anyone out there skeptic, debunker, believer, whatever. I don't think there's anyone who's going to listen to her and not believe that she is experiencing what she's experiencing. It is so rare that that type of authenticity and clarity and real innocence comes through. But here it is. For non-subscribers, after these messages, for subscribers, let's meet Crystal right now. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant. But then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the program, Crystal. Crystal, thank you so much for doing this. I cannot wait to talk about unicorns and so much more.
I am very excited to share this with you, really.
Yeah, it's not often, as I've told you, it's not often that I hear people taking unicorns seriously as an experience and that I believe them. But in this case, I actually believe you, so I can't wait to hear this. But first, you seem to have had, I don't know if it's a lifetime of experiences or just since you were, from when you were married on. What are some of your earliest experiences, be they high strangeness or spiritual or whatever it is you want to call them?
I would say that when I got married last June, that's when this other stage of awakening happened. Where, I mean, I was not a person who had had any kind of experiences with out-of-body experience or any kind of, I don't know, paranormal or, you know, interdimensional beings type of experience. In fact, you know, after having these experiences, my brother, who was living in Belize at the time, he's now back here, we're in California, and, you know, he was the one who kind of put the words, some of the words to it and kind of put the explanation to it because he had a UFO experience a while ago. And he's the one who introduced me to your podcast, in fact, and he introduced me to like Whitley Strieber and just a lot of other things, which until last June or July, really, I didn't know much about on the conscious level. I'm going to say that within myself, kind of in, you know, within my trueness to who I am as a person, that there's, I've always felt a connection to, you know, a spiritual connection. I was born in Spain and my family is very Catholic and my family in Spain is very Catholic and I didn't really connect. I had a rosary and I didn't connect to it. And we grew up, my father was in the military and we were living in different countries and, you know, we went to Sri Lanka for a month. We went to Kenya for a month. We lived in Saudi Arabia for 4 years. We lived in Spain. We lived in the United States. It's like all these different intense religions and experiences. And I remember at 10 just kind of thinking that everybody was really connected to the same thing, but interpreted it in their own ways. And so it wasn't until after my wedding that I actually had some of these other experiences that I shared with you.
Well, when you say other, what I mean, okay, so that's sort of a philosophical outlook, but were there experiences that went along with those? And that they then changed over the course of your wedding?
I worked at a camp for 10 summers, a summer camp, starting when I was around seven. Well, I went there as a camper when I was 16. And this camp is in California, in the Sierra Nevadas. And then I then worked there for 9 years after that. And the last summer that I was there at that camp, I was saying goodbye to the camp. You know, I was like, I'm saying goodbye to you. I'm going to be gone. I said these words out loud with my voice. And I'm going to miss you. You've been a really amazing place because I learned so much about myself from the camp director, from the experiences there. And I felt in that moment, this is where I would think kind of my first confirmation or embrace or something from outside of myself and my mind. And that wasn't in a sort of religious doctrine, where I felt like the land and the area was saying goodbye to me and was saying, we appreciated you. I felt it and I heard it in my head, you know, and I felt this embrace and I felt like, thank you for being here and we're going to miss you too. And that would be, I guess, my first thought of having that kind of a connection.
Huh. And so what was your feeling of connection to the land prior to that moment? I mean, did it make sense to you that the land would be missing you or thanking you for having been there? Were you a good steward to the earth?
It did make sense to me. My mother never, she was very Spanish, grew up in the era of Franco, in fact, a dictator. And to her, like, going camping was dirty and it was dirt and bugs and, you know, you don't want to be close to nature. And I was like, but why? I want to be close to nature. I want to go camping. I want to do these things. And she denied that, you know, no, that's not good. So by the point when I was 16, when I first went to this, was because of a friend who I had met who lived across the street from me. We had just moved into this town. You know, we had just come back from Saudi Arabia. And she had been going to this camp since she was a little girl. And from the moment I met her, that's all we talked about. She had just got back and she spoke about this place. And I knew I needed to go to this place. And in high school, also, I had a field biology class where they took us backpacking. And I went on 5 amazing backpacking trips because my mother would never take us camping, wouldn't allow that because it was dirty. So when I had these opportunities through these other sources, through my friend and through my high school, and I took the field biology class, I was on those mountains in the Sierra Nevadas on the rocks and just amazing. Yeah, I felt nature and I felt the majesty of it. And right now I live in Northern California and we were married in a redwood grove. And I do. It makes sense to me. It makes perfect sense. I never questioned that connection when I felt it.
Do you think that if you lived there and you just had bare bones resources and you were to ask the location or ask the earth essentially how to live, do you think you would in some way receive an answer and be okay?
Maybe. You say the earth, and I would say I asked that to the universe. I did start doing that a while ago. I would put out my thoughts to the universe, and I would say that to the universe, I'm asking, I'm looking for guidance, and I would put that out there. And then I would go with resolutions that I came from that. I don't know.
Yeah, that's probably roughly the same. The reason I ask is the thing that sticks with me about what my friend Teokasin Ghost Horse says about culture is that culture comes from the land. And he's Lakota. And I've run this by my friend Willie, who's a Hawaiian elder, and he says the same thing. So the idea that the culture comes from the land, I wonder if then it can ever really be killed, you know, when Westerners come in and, you know, for instance, in Hawaii, make speaking Hawaiian illegal, make doing the hula illegal and all that. And now They're starting to get their culture back, but it's still sort of a Christianized different version. It's not the original. But I wonder if one were to listen, or even maybe specifically Hawaiians were to just simply listen to the land, would the language and would all of the original stuff that was important to the land come back through them? I just wonder if we make too big of a deal of survival in some way, you know, in this disconnected way.
Yeah. No, I understand that.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle, it's available in paperback, and there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
So, okay. So how did that inform you in a lasting way? In other words, you have that experience. And what do you carry with you in a lasting way from that? Because I imagine as a teenager, you know, you go through all the normal teenage crap and maybe become a jerk for a little while and then become an adult. Is that how it goes? Or were you pretty much a good person all the way through?
You know, I got to say that even a friend of mine recently who from high school confirmed that she's like, you were actually pretty good, because I didn't, you know, I had scoliosis and I wore a back brace all through high school. So, you know, people are funny when you're not, when you have to wear something like that. I wore a back brace underneath my clothes, and they have their judgments, they have their restrictions. And but I wasn't from that particular town. We moved constantly in my life. We moved from one place to another, which is, and lived in many parts of the world and met many different people. And so my core, I mean, one thing that I learned from many of those experiences was, one, my core was my family. And then I also had pen pals and learned to maintain relationships that were important that I met in different places. And so when I was in high school and people weren't accepting of me, I really truly understood that that wasn't my issue, that that was their issue. And that I had this brace that was, you know, that was under my clothes and they could see. So I actually did connect with many different groups rather than one group, and just kind of saw people as people, and we all have our issues. But what was your question? Because I think I got off track.
No, that was basically, I was basically just asking, did you have sort of the normal ins and outs, highs and lows of you know, childhood and teenhood, or were you basically a stable sort of good person all the way through? Because I'm wondering, you know, what of that experience stuck with you all the way? What did you keep with you all the way through from that experience of feeling, well, as though the land is animated in some way and speaking to you?
Sure. Well, you know, I think I felt that in other places too. You know, in Sri Lanka, we climbed this mountain to see this Buddha at the top. And, you know, we were in places of incredible beauty. In Kenya, there was all the animals and the land and the landscape. And then Saudi Arabia, the dunes and the heat. And then the south of Spain, where I was born, and we went back there quite often. The beaches and just, you know, also the heat. And, you know, I don't know, but I think that that sense of connection to nature and being happy always when I was out in nature has always been with me. So it wasn't necessarily new in high school. It's just something that I knew was important to maintain in my life. So when I had that experience of the land saying goodbye to me and hearing it, like I heard it speak to me, that was like reaffirming. That was like, you know, a coming home almost. Like, I knew this was a connection. I knew this was real. And it was very reaffirming to me. But it's not something I've shared with a lot of people because, you know, I don't know what people are going to think. So right. In that way, I've restricted it. I don't want to be thought of as being clinically insane, you know, by the normal public and society.
Well, you're not speaking to the normal public, so you're good.
I'm being very open. I feel like that's true.
So, okay, when you say speak, then you mean you heard of an external voice or an internal voice or an intuiting? What do you mean?
I heard an internal. Well, I heard a voice, an external voice internally.
Okay.
Within me.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Saying these things, like bidding me goodbye. And I felt like an embrace. I felt a physical, like, electricity and energizing of the air around me embracing me at that moment.
And would you say then that it's great that you're this world traveler and you've been to all of these different lands and you feel them all. So do they feel different, or are they all just different in the way that they're beautiful in different ways?
Yeah, I think the second one, it's like they're different in their own unique beauty. You know, every place has its distinct, you know, uniqueness about it. It's not as though land is land. It's every place has its own spirit.
Right. That's what I'm asking, because, you know, in Hawaii, you know, we talk about Pele a lot. And I'm just wondering if different lands have a different sort of, I don't know, archetypal character to them, or if that's the right term to use.
I think so. I wouldn't be able to tell you all those, though, but that feels true to me.
Okay. Okay. So, when you got married, and of course people call that settling down, was that settling down for you? Were you living this life bopping all around the world until then, or had you settled on a location to live prior to that?
I think that probably, I hadn't thought of it like that, but yeah, settling down. I was quite an anarchist and non-monogamous and many things. And so for a good portion of my adult life, early adult life. So settling down is definitely the case. I mean, my kids are, their father is in Spain, their biological father. And the, you know, the man I married has been their father since my youngest was about 2.5. But he's somebody I've known for about 20 years. So yeah, I mean, I do think that it was, but then, you know, I had this revelation when we got married. I just really felt, again, the place we got married was a redwood grove. And as soon as I entered that place, I always immediately felt this sense of peace and this sense of, this is the right place. And this sense of, we are soulmates, and we're, rather than settling down, we are reuniting.
Right. Yeah. But I don't know if you've listened to enough of the show to know that I sort of harp on George Hansen's trickster theory, which doesn't say, you know, why, as he once scolded me, why is not a fruitful question. But it just sort of explains the patterns around paranormal and spiritual experiences, one of which is that they seem to happen in anti-structural moments, when you're moving, when you're getting divorced, when you get a new job. Something like this is when it's almost like the blinders come off your reality tunnel and the larger ecology around you seeps in. And it's interesting because you would be sort of the reverse example of that. You were living a chaotic life, and your anti-structural moment was structure. You got married, you settled down, and then suddenly you had a big change. So what was that big change, and when did it occur, and what happened?
Well, see, for me, what really, it wasn't necessarily the married, it was the pain that I went through because of all the physical activity I did during the wedding. It was this intense pain that I've never felt before in my back, because in the end, I ended up being the person, we got married on a Monday due to finances, it was cheaper, you know, it was like half the cost of renting the Grove out on a weekend. And what I didn't anticipate is so many people would then leave that night and we would be on our own. And so that the next day as well, I would be the one mainly cleaning up the wedding. And in the end, I ended up being in more pain than I've ever been in. And I'm somebody who's, most of the people around me are like, you have a high tolerance for pain. And I do agree, you know, even childbirth was not one of those things I see in these, you know, in movies or where the people are screaming and I'm like, well, that's not what it's like for me. And so I don't relate to that. So this was pain for me. This was pain. And it was that breathing that I did and that like moving away from the pain that moved me into these other experiences. And it was the people around me who I then, when I called out for help, because rather than calling out to the universe, I posted on Facebook. That's
you do what you got to do.
But that is a call to the universe, that's but it's true. A modern Facebook. I'm in pain, intense pain. I need a therapist now. And I don't typically spend money on massages because I can't afford so really normally, you know, and I ended up spending a lot of money this summer after the wedding on different massages and different things to help, and which I'm still recovering from. And I ended up realizing that really those the massage, all that stuff wasn't really, I don't know. It's like the pain was there for a reason. It's kind of what my brother said. Maybe it was there to move you into these experiences. And now I'm not in that pain that I was in. You know, I get some pains, but they're not to the same level. But what happened with that pain is, you know, when I got the massage, when the person who was, I live in a smaller town, so you know everybody, like everybody who was involved in my wedding was somebody I knew. So my photographer, my, you know, the person who made the cakes, the person who came, well, the caterer, I didn't know, but she was recommended by a person I work with. And, you know, it's a small community in that sense, so that everybody, there was a lot of meaning, like the people who played the music at our wedding, you know, teach my son, her is his music teacher, he plays trombone, and they were there and played music. And so when I put that message on Facebook, my wedding photographer, she was the one who then said, hey, you can go to this person. They live here in town. They're willing to take you right now. And then these friends who I knew from the camp that I told you about happened to be visiting this one boy. Oh, he's a man now, but he was a boy when I first met him. And he became a pen pal with me. I was his counselor his last year at camp. And so he was living in the UK and he happened to be in town right when I was looking for a massage therapist. And my husband was visiting his parents, who it was important for him to be with them at the hotel because his mother and father, his father's 90, his mother has been going through chemotherapy. We didn't even know she'd be at the wedding. So I didn't want to take those last possible moments, you know, from him. They rarely get up here and they were here. So he was with them a lot, which is why a lot of the work fell on me. And then, so this all coincided and I ended up getting this massage here in town. And I've had massages before, but never had an out of body experience as happened in that moment. And that's where the transformation took place.
Yeah, that would be a transformation. All right. Well, tell me, what was the initiatory part of like the out of body experience? I mean, are you, do you know you're out of your body the second you're out of your body, or does it take a second to go, wait a minute, what's going on here?
Well, I had no idea because I wasn't seeking to be out of my body. I was seeking to be rid of the pain. But even when the friends came, I told them, I said, well, you can come visit me, but I have to be honest. I'm in so much pain that I'm like a toddler right now. I can't concentrate from one moment to the next. I'm having a very difficult time staying present. And they're like, well, my friend, he's like, I still want to come see you. And and my wife and my daughter, I want you to meet them. And he's known me. So he was laughing. He was like, okay. He saw me when he got there. He's like, she's not being normal. Like I retrospectively see that I was already moving out of my body before I even got to the massage because the pain was so intense. I was stepping away from it. You know, physically, I was like trying not to focus on it. I didn't want it to stop me from doing anything. I was about to go into my honeymoon and I wanted I had to get my kids going with my sister and then I was going to go on my honeymoon and I didn't want the pain to inhibit me and stop me from doing that. So I was finding a way to separate myself from it. So that when I went into the massage, I remember her like massaging and I was breathing and she was really complimenting my breathing. Wow, that's really good breathing, you know, really deep breathing. So I know that was a part of it. And I remember moving, like breathing out as she would push and move the muscles and kind of like move the pain. And I could feel this physical sensation of like heat and pain as it moved up through my right arm towards my shoulder. And that's where it got really intense on my right arm as she was moving up towards my shoulder. And then she asked me to turn over. And at that point, that's where it changed. And I didn't know I was going into an out-of-body experience. I just know that I don't even really remember turning over. The last thing I truly remember was that pain in my arm and the breath, as I was breathing out that pain. And I turned over, and then I can tell you the experience, but I don't remember when it started.
Okay.
Do you want to hear that now?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So that's when I was out. What I remember is all of a sudden it was like time didn't exist. It was the future. It was the past. It was the present. And I was floating. I felt like I was floating and I was in like entering bubbles. And I entered this bubble and I was experiencing and everybody in the bubble was happy and they were joyous and happy and celebrating. And then I would move to a different bubble and it would be other people that I knew. And in the wedding, I had felt disconnected from like, what were other people's experiences? Because as the bride, my experience, I didn't really get time to spend time with anybody. And I had that question in my head. And these moments that I were moving into were kind of, a lot of them were connected to people's joy around this wedding and the Grove, because it was a very magical place. And I'm adding that. I don't know if they thought it was magical. I say it's magical.
Okay.
But I didn't know what people were experiencing. And part of that moment I felt like I was experiencing was going into those bubbles of these different circles of, you know, 'cause I have friends or, you know, my husband's family or, you know, my family and different connections of people. I mean, there were about 80 altogether, so it wasn't a huge wedding, but there were different groups of people anyhow from different connections. And I just felt like I was moving into those. But then I also, like, I had these bubbles of, you know, like I said, maybe there were things that happened that I didn't even know were happening yet. It could have been the future. I don't know. And then there were things from, like, way when I was little that it was just these really happy moments. And then she cleared her throat. The massage therapist went, not even a very loud sound, but it was enough of a sound in this world that all of a sudden that's when I felt a change, like a whooshing, like shoo, and this weight all of a sudden and a warm fuzziness around me And I felt myself being pulled, and I saw a thread, like a golden thread, wavy. And I felt this falling into my body with, I could even like, woof, and I fell into my body. And that's when I realized, whoa, I was out of my body. That's the moment I realized it.
So when you were out of your body, did you see your body on the table?
No, I didn't see my body because I didn't even know I was out of my body till I fell back into my body.
And the cord, was that connected to you?
I didn't see it connected to me. I maybe felt that it was. It was very thin. It was like a thread. And I kind of assumed, I guess, that it was because I was following it. It was more like a path that I was following.
And when you were sort of immersed in this experience, were are you able to like move your perception as if you're moving your head or your eyes?
You know, again, it caught me by surprise. I've read other experiences that, you know, in my past about people having out of body experiences. And so it all afterwards made sense. And that's why I recognized all these things as making sense as to out of body. But then I also then researched it after the experience more too. And, you know, I recently, just the other day, did a longer meditation and started to feel myself move out of my body in the same way, but it scared me because I don't know a lot about it. And I kind of want a guide. I want somebody to help me learn about this process, and I don't know who to turn to. And because I just don't know, how do you find somebody to help you learn about how to do that and what it means more and to explore it more? I do feel like I could, because this first experience was not something I was trying to do.
Right. Would you say that visually things were sort of hyper real? Was it sort of high definition, more real than real?
It wasn't more real than real. It was like, it was real. It was every moment I went into was as though I were there, but nobody knew I was there. It was, I was witnessing them. They weren't interacting with me, but I was standing there as real as they were.
Okay. And so how would you compare that state to, I don't know if you've ever had a lucid dream or if you've done hallucinogens, but if you have either of those, how would you compare it?
So I haven't done any kind of hallucinogens. I think lucid dreaming is fascinating. I haven't actually learned how to lucid dream, but all of those things, I mean, it's fascinating to me. It's interesting, but no, that's not been a part of my experience.
So really do you have anything to compare it to?
I don't really, which is why this is like blown my mind, you know, and then the experiences that came after. And truly the closest I have to a guide is my brother, who I've shared these with more openly. And he kind of understands, doesn't question, and just pushes me to understand it farther and connected me to you, you know?
fool, the fool that he is. No. What was the interconnection with like? What was that feeling like? I mean, is it love? Is it oneness? Is it I am that? Or is it something else?
Yeah, I mean, I think love and home and joy is what I could mostly say. Joy, ecstasy, joy. Really, I felt that's what I felt overall.
And as you know, that sound means our time is up. But I want to thank Crystal, and I also want to tell you all, anyone out there who wants to contact her, you don't have to go through me. She has set up a Gmail account specifically for this, so you can contact her directly. CrystalNebula3@gmail.com. 3 is the number 3, not spelled out, so it's all one word. CrystalNebula3. @gmail.com. And if for some reason you have a problem getting through there, you can always contact me, jeremy@unknowncountry.com, and I will forward your email. All right. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Thank you, Crystal. And spoiler alert, her brother has contacted me. So we will hopefully tape an episode in the very near future. All right. Take care, everybody. And we'll see you next week.